to turn with me in your Bibles. And I want you to keep your Bibles open, if you will, because I will refer to it and lead you in it. Thank you. The first scripture that I'm going to read to you is from the Psalms. It is from the 33rd Psalm and verse 11. It begins there. And I want to start my remarks on this. And while you're turning, I want to say welcome to you in the service today, and a number of you are visiting. I want to get to meet you when the service is over, down front here. I want to say to Brother Poquette, Phil, is that you right there? Lift your hand up. Would you do that? I want you to praise the Lord for his being able to be with us today. Can we do that? And he has been under all kinds of fire. All kinds of things have happened in his family. The passing of his mother, who was one of our staff members. A great accountant and bookkeeper here in the church. She was Faye Parker then. And she later retired and moved away and got married to Sonny. Faye, some time ago, went home to be with the Lord. And her son, Mark, who is a member of this church, has been helping with his family and is able to be back with us today. Mark, over there, would you? I want everybody to praise the Lord for Mark being able to be here. We love you, Mark. I might tell you that when we used to go on the jungle trips, Mark would wear the hat, and when we'd go through the place, they would say, you're Harrison Ford, aren't you? You're from the Raiders of the Lost Ark, aren't you? and he played the part. But it's been a great man taking his guitar and leading the people in the song, the kids with songs, and it's just been one of the greatest. How many others are visiting today? Let me see your hand. If you're visiting with us, we're glad to have you here. I'll meet you down front here if I could, just to get your name, if that's all right with you, if you will do it for me. Psalm 33, verse 12, verse 11. The counsel of the Lord stands forever. It never ends. The thoughts of his heart to all generations. I'm assuming that he means his generation then, and since he does not change, he means for us right now. Can I get a witness from somebody? Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance. The Lord looks down from heaven. He beholds all of the sons, that means daughters too, of men. From the place of his habitation, he looks upon all the inhabitants of the earth. He fashions their hearts alike and considers all of their works. There is no king saved by the multitude of a host. A mighty man is not delivered by so much strength. A horse is a vain thing to depend on for safety. Neither shall he deliver any by his great strength. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive in the famine. That's a reading of a scripture, and I want you to be seated. Thank you very much. It is a supreme moment for the United States of America, God's country. We must be ready to go down on our knees. It was the word of Charles Spurgeon, the young preacher in England, who said, these things come from knee work. You'll find that in Wesley Duell's book on A Blaze for God, the great missionary. Many a nation has faced defeat and elimination before. Many a nation has been to the exact same place that we are in right now. We do not find ourselves in a unique situation, as many people would have you to think. When the leaders of those nations called upon the Lord, they entered into a period of fasting and praying with sackcloth and ashes upon their heads and their backs. They would wear no good clothes. They would put burlap type of cloth, the most common thing they could find, and took ashes, literally, put the ashes on their faces and body, and put the ashes on their heads. They would do no anointing, no beauty shop stuff, but they would come before the Lord with a contrite spirit, and God would answer them with revival. It wasn't done with any hocus pocus. It was done by humiliation. Some of us do not understand that word humiliation. We think that it's of the devil. But this was one where a volitional, do-it-yourself humiliation came, and where people said, Lord, let me decrease and let you increase. One of the instances was when Hezekiah prayed, and the next morning, 185,000 Assyrians were slain by the angels of the Lord in the hills. They killed themselves, is what they did, turned on each other. Another example is in 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, and verse 20 through 22. I want to just read you some of this. In the 17th verse, he says, you shall not need to fight in this battle. Here is your point. You do not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves ahead and stand still and see the salvation of the Lord with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Fear not, nor be thou dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. And Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. And the Levites came along. They are the ones who give the scriptures and do the holy fighting for God and the worship. They arose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness, verse 20, of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, listen, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper. I want you to put this country right where we're talking. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord. They should praise the beauty. Watch this. I want you to remember this because you think it's not in there. To praise the beauty of holiness. Everybody say it with me. Come on. Say it with me. The beauty of holiness. I just want you to know that it's there. When this church started out of the Methodist Church in 1898, they said, we don't believe that the word holiness is in the Bible. It's all through it. It's even called the Holy Bible. I can back that up with documents. And they went out before the army to say, here's what they said. Praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. And when they began, you hear this, when they began to sing and to praise the Lord, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon and Moab and the Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. And they looked around, and verse 24 says, behold, they were dead bodies fallen to the earth, and none escaped. And of course, they had a revival like you never dreamed they would have, because they were up for total annihilation. Now, I thought that instead of just me preaching all the time right here, that we might sing during one of my messages, okay? So let it catch you a little off guard. I've given you a little bit of a warning. I want you to act with this choir as a choir. And I want the instrumentalists to put it together, and I don't want anything that's, I want it strong and hard. I want it overhead so you can see it. That we are not going to live in defeat, we're going to live in victory. That God has not called this country to defeat, he's called it to victory. Can I get a witness? Can you put your hands together and clap them? Come on, glory. Now on your feet, everybody. Now I want you to sing. Chuck, come and lead us.
I heard an old, old story, how the Savior came from glory. Sing. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood. Yeah.
on, shout it out. Hallelujah. Let's give God some praise. Come on. Let all of God's saints give him some noise today. Come on. I give you the 19th verse again if you want it. It says that Israel shouted with a loud voice on high.
Glory.
It wasn't one of these little, hey, Lord, thank you, Lord. It was a glory.
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 Hallelujah.
Glory.
That's what it said. Why do we have to go and do opposite? Glory.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Oh,
bless the Lord. Betty, you and Arlene chose to come back on a great day. Praise the Lord. Isn't it good to shout the praises of God? Is that George Shooter? Is George Shooter here? He's not here. I thought I saw him come in back there. We're praying and believing God. We're believing God that during this time, the next, what have I got? Exactly 31 minutes. And then we're going to set up a prayer time and ask others to join us in prayer. You can be seated. Thank you. Now, I speak thank you, guys, and be ready. Victory in Jesus. There are many other instances. I will choose only those to mention those to you right now. This country was born in prayer. Do not let any liberal, I'm not political at all, I'm just saying don't let any left thinker, right thinker, light thinker, or no thinker tell you that we were not born in prayer. This nation was born praying on its knees. It began in legislative meetings. You'd say they didn't do it then. They were so highbrow, they didn't do it. Yes, they did. In congressional meetings, they never did a congressional meeting unless they prayed, until they started backsliding on it. But they started backsliding. The group engaged in prayer and called upon the Lord's blessings on them for the business that they were going to do to bring about this republic. On June the 28th, 1787, now it had already started, this nation had, in 76. That means it took 11 years for this to happen. Only 11 years. And here we are today on, I don't know how many hundred it is, 100 and some, whatever it is, 200 years or something that we're having a birthday, but it's a birthday for our country. I know it's a birthday mainly for people who are walking up down the road. I went to Lumberton the other day to see Roland Horn, and it took me an hour or two extra to get there almost because there were so many people going down and up. It was bumper to bumper. I mean, it was something else. And I understand that. It's part of the program, part of the plan. It's good. Everybody has to go. We want to go. Everybody goes. It's all right. But this country was born on that day, 1776. And on June the 28th, 1787, at the Constitutional Convention, they had a speech made by somebody that you would not believe would make a speech like this. Because you heard, and I heard, that this man only talked about women and drinking booze and getting high and no God. His name was Benjamin Franklin. He gave a speech following a bitter debate in that meeting today, that congressional meeting. And this debate took place regarding large states, colonies, and small little bitty colonies. They were talking about representation. Everybody wanted to be represented. And it looked like big states were saying, wait a minute, you don't count as much as we count. How many of us know that it doesn't take long until you'll start, if you're not careful, letting the devil come in and bring pride, and you'll think you're greater than everybody else? Can I get a witness from somebody? It happens in the nations the same way. It happens in the country the same way. And it is happening in ours the same way right now. At 81 years old, whether he was plugged in again or the first time or not, this message was given by Benjamin Franklin. It is very short, but I am going to read the message that he gave to the Continental Congress, to this Congress that was meeting following the beginning of this republic. The feelings got so hostile that the smaller groups were pitted against the bigger groups. And they had almost the first civil war to break out 11 years after they got free. It was so rough that some of the delegates from the colonies walked out of the Congress and said, we will not be a part of it. And they left and went home. So contrary to what you think, that for the last so many years after they got started, they were just all saying, oh, we got a great country. Oh, what a great country. What a great country we've got. Folks, it doesn't take long to turn sour when the devil gets his hand into it. Franklin gave this speech, and he talked about one thing, going down on our knees in prayer as a nation. I wouldn't have expected it from him. I wouldn't. But he said, this nation has begun to lose its divine illumination. And I pick up there from where he said of allowing God Almighty to show this country the right path to follow. And here we go with what he said. In the beginning of the contest with Great Britain, when we were sensible of the danger, we had daily prayer in this room we are in right now for the divine protection. Our prayers, sir, were heard, and they were graciously answered by our God. All of us who were engaged in the struggle must have observed frequent instances of his superintending providence in our favor. To that kind of providence, we owe this happy opportunity of consulting in peace on the means of establishing our future national facility and felicity. And have we now forgotten that powerful freedom that came from that powerful friend? Or do we imagine we no longer need his assistance? And Franklin went on without stopping. He said, I have lived, sir, a long time. And the longer I live, the more convincing proofs I see of this truth, that God governs in the affairs of men. And if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, is it probable that an empire can rise without his aid? We have been assured, sir, in the sacred writings of the Bible, that except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. I firmly believe this because I have seen it. And I also believe that without his concurring aid, we shall succeed in this political building no better than the builders of the Tower of Babel, confused and failing. We shall be divided by a partial local interest. Our projects will be confounded, and we ourselves shall become a reproach and a byword down to future ages. And what is worse, mankind may hereafter, from this unfortunate instance, despair of establishing governments by human wisdom and leave it to chance, to war and conquest. I therefore beg leave to move that henceforth prayer, imploring, and begging the assistance of heaven and its blessing on our deliberations be held in this assembly every morning before we proceed to business, and that one or more of the clergy of this city be requested to officiate in that service. And he went and sat down. Franklin had given his soul to say that we are on a collision course. We must go down on our knees. The speech, by the way, you could read it yourself if you'd like. I might have added a couple of words there, but only for emphasis. It's recorded in James Madison, who didn't miss anything, in James Madison's notes of debates in the Federal Convention of 1787. These notes, along with many others, let us know that our first leaders, look, knew that we couldn't have a republic unless we depended upon prayer and God to bring the necessity of this nation to become a real success for him. He wasn't the only one. I won't quote him, but you've heard quotes and you've read them, I'm sure many of you have. But there was George Washington. There was Thomas Jefferson. There was Abraham Lincoln. And in the past, I met myself with President, one of them, George W. Bush, and I watched him pray in Southeast Florida at Southeastern Seminary. We learned that when the country was at odds with another nation and they didn't know what to do, he and another leader of another nation, a man by the name of Tony Blair, when they got to the White House, they said, "Let's go down on our knees in prayer and ask for the divine guidance of God to guide our nation." We are in desperate need of unity, but not for someone to say, "Look, I'm a Democrat and you're a Republican, let's get together." That's like telling Niagara Falls to stop running. You're not going to get it like that. Where is our thinking? Where is our brain? The unity that I believe that we can only have is the unity that is brought to us by the Spirit of the living God. There is no man wise enough in the Senate or the Congress or in the Cabinet or anywhere there to call on a unified nation in a time of distress other than you who know how to call on him. You who know that God will not let you down. You who have read the sacred writ and you know what God does when he says, do nothing but stand still and see that I am God. The battle is not yours, but the battle belongs to God. You say, but John, it's going to take some extra parleying. And it is, but it's going to be directed by the hand of Almighty God. We are in desperate need of that unity. Now, I know that some say, well, I don't like your God. My God is Muhammad. Well, you can try to wake him up, but he's still in the tomb. And another could come along and say, my God is one of the others, like Shinto, or like Confucius, or like Moon, or like the Dalai Lama. But they are not anything but rock dead. How are you going to get a brick to speak to you? But men become like this because Satan begins to turn them against God with his anti-Christ, anti-God ways, as John told us in the Revelation and as John told us in the little book of John, 1 John chapter 2. Then men begin to say, well, maybe we need something else to bring us. Look at what it's brought us when those people turn their back upon God and say, we will not have him in our courthouse, and we will not have him in the school buildings, and we will not have him in our families, and we will not have him in our churches. I beg you, if it were my last time, and sometimes God knows I think it may be my last time, I would urge you, I would implore you, leave other things off rather than leaving off the going to your knees and asking God for his help. It is God on our knees, us on our knees, who implores God and who brings the victory every time. As you saw last week when Finney brought about a revival even beforehand, we must let it come when people pray. Now, there is an urgency about that. It's a real urgency on my part because I believe that if you mark the last days, now, I want every one of you to hear this. If you mark the last days, and if you are a student of the book, as I believe many of you are, you will read what the Lord gave to St. Paul's in the book of Thessalonians. For while we are saying we believe that a revival is coming just prior to the coming of Christ, I liked what David Jeremiah said in one of his latest works on the apocalypse, when he said, contrary to belief, I do not believe that the thing that's going to precede the coming of the Jesus Christ is going to be a great revival. I said, whoa. He said, turn to John and see what God gave to Paul and see what God gave to John, and turn and hear what Paul said, that before this coming of the Antichrist can come, before this coming of Jesus can come, there must first come a great apostasy, a falling away. And that falling away, there is the word apostasia. It means falling away. It doesn't mean sinners going away. It means the church going away. Now, I want you with your spiritual eye to look at the church today and see if the church is really on fire for God. See which one of them is preaching the old-fashioned, hell-bent, God-believing, Jesus coming, rapture appearing, salvation, that is on the way. I believe that we must go to that moment when we go down on our knees and say, God, we must have a revival or we will die if we're going to keep a republic. I'm just saying it to you today. My dear friends, I urge you, I beg you, believe that God is going to drop a revival on us. I do believe it. Because I believe that the coming is right around the corner. But I don't believe it's just yet. There are some things that have got to happen. Nothing before the rapture, but before the coming of the Antichrist. I believe that we must be ready. And instead of going out on this, I'm going to come back next week and talk to you about that beast that comes out of the earth. And that false prophet, the Antichrist. And that revival that he's going to bring and his signs that he's going to bring and the mark of the beast next Sunday. I want you to be here because the Lord is dealing with me some strangely ways on this. What I am saying to you, if we are going to have a revival, we must have the revival breaking now. We cannot say, Lord, in the sweet by and by, you'll bring a revival. It must be now. It must be greater than our preaching. It must be greater than our Sunday school. It must be greater than our music. It must be greater than anything that we can do. It is going down on our knees toward God before he is going to hear from heaven. That's what happened here, and all of it got in line. If you believe that, if you've got enough strength today, clap your hands and praise the Lord and say, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Now, I know that we depend on those things. And I'm down to 10 more minutes, okay? Don't believe just anything that you hear. It doesn't matter what they say. Believe what the Word of God says. And the Word of God comes to me with this word, expediency. Well, you know, Reverend, one of these days I'll get down on my knees and I'll get God. Now. Now is the time to stand still and see the salvation of God. Right now is the time. I say it with urgency. I don't say it yelling at you. I say it with urgency, though, that this is the moment. This is a kairos, a supreme moment when we must have, listen, an epiphany, when we must have a Pentecostal blessing where we want God more than we need anything else. Now judge yourselves about what you want today and see if you are at that point today where you would give up anything in order to have God to bring a great revival down on this city. And I believe that that move of God, and I am not contradictory, I believe that that move of God is on us. But I believe that you have seen the foretaste, the forerunner of the falling away. And you have seen churches fall away. And you are seeing 100 and some churches. Listen to me. You're not listening to me. I am seeing 100 and some churches die out every month in the United States of God's America. We are seeing churches in England that are being sold to the Muslims, and the gospel does not ring from those pulpits anymore. Do you understand what I'm saying? We are seeing, and this is what Marxism wants to do. I won't go over into Marxism. I could. This is what Marxism and communism and socialism wants to do. Socialism being the first that brings on the Marxism. And if you're for socialism, you'll say, I'm going to be for communism. Stop waiting for everything to happen for you. Ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. John F. Kennedy. And I'm saying today that the greatest thing you can do for your country, You're already given 30 or 40% of your taxes, and you're going to be called on to give more taxes, more and more and more. And gasoline is up in the last 3 months, $1 a gallon more. And if it takes me 12 or 14 gallons to fill my tank, I'm spending $12 to $14 every time I refill it, more than I did 6 months ago or earlier. I don't have to tell you about food that has gone up 30%. And go to a restaurant, and you'll say, well, thank goodness they didn't go up here. They didn't. They just came down in what they serve. There'll be a compensation right there. And go over to Walmart or go over to Food Lion or to Harris Teeter or somewhere and see them and watch, put it together. It will mesmerize you to sleep. You're doing all of these things. What can you do? Where could I go but down on my knees toward God? This is the time. This is the place we must pray as a church. Now, I can't get into Cedar Falls, and I can't get into the Methodist Church, but I can get into one that's big enough right here to stem the tide, and it is here. Now, I want to ask you, what if I gave you somebody who prophesied this very thing? And I will, and here it goes. A man about 200 years or more ago in Scotland, a very wise professor by the name of Dr. Professor Tytler, studied the ancient civilizations of Athens, it's Athenian democracy. You know they were the first to come on with the democracy. And then he studied the rise and the fall of the Roman Empire that I've mentioned to you three or four times. I don't want you to read that because it's going to blow your mind when you read the rise and the fall of just sections of it. You can't read it all at one time unless you're a worm. Some of you got the mentality to do it. I have to read sections. It's too much for me. When they start skinning those people that are buried and tied to a stake, it's more than this man can take. And to watch them have a party in front of them and do sexual orgies and to see what that empire came and fell to and came from. To watch its rise and then watch its fall. It's called the rise. Here it is, the rise and the fall of the Roman Empire. Tytler studied it all. I'm sure David Barton's done the same thing. I think his name is David. Is it David Barton? Isn't that right? You've read him? David Barton. Good for you to read. Tytler said, I want to talk about what I found. He said, a democracy is always temporary in nature. It simply cannot exist as a permanent form of government. It will continue to exist up until the time that voters, watch this, that voters discover that they can vote for themselves generous gifts from the public funds. From that moment on, the majority always votes the candidates who promise the most benefits from the public treasury. From the public treasury, from the public treasury, from the public treasury. Please loosen it. It's hung from the public treasury. I can't get it off from the public treasury. It's hung. I can't. From the public treasury, from the public treasury. It's broken loose. With the result that every democracy will finally, watch, collapse. Due to loose fiscal policy, which is always followed by a dictatorship. Here is the following spiral that works inversely, and I will show you on the PowerPoint. If you can read that, Tytler said this, I did not. From bondage, think of the First Nation here now, 1776. Professor Tytler said, from bondage, before it ever came about, from bondage to spiritual faith, it moves upward. It moves upward from spiritual faith to great courage. From great courage to liberty, it's moving upwards now. Watch our nation. And from great liberty to great abundance. And it stops. It has stopped, okay? You may not be aware of it, but it's stopped. I feel it, and I think you can too. And I wonder, Mike, Brother Anderson, I think we can handle it, okay? We're along the way, and y'all aren't as old, but I mean, I think that we can handle it. But I don't know what young couples are going to do. With babies, with 3 and 4 babies, 5, I don't know what they're going to do. You're going to see it, baby. Just watch and see. He said, then it turns around. Now watch our nation. We're about at the halfway point. From abundance that it reached, it goes down to complacency. In other words, and then it goes down to apathy. Here's what the professor asked the students. What are the 2 major things that's wrong with our nation? And he called on one guy and he just said, I don't know and I don't care. That's apathy. And that's complacency. And then it goes from apathy down to dependency, where we are dependent on the United States government to bring our, think on it, to bring our hospitalization. Oh, yes, brother. Bring me the hospitalization, put it in my pocket. You know it's there. You can look at me like that if you want to, but you know it's there. Oh, and now we want it to be for our education. You'd say, well, you can't do it. I paid every cent of mine to the United States government when I borrowed it and worked the rest of the way. You can do it. You can do it. But we want the government to do it. And from the government, it leads to bondage, Tytler said. And that, my friend, is tyranny. And he said, it normally ends. A democracy normally always ends. Are you ready for this? With a dictator. I didn't say it. He said it. Keep your eyes on God. I don't mean to alarm you, but I wish I could. It is still the greatest country in this world, and it is his country. I read you at first, whose nation is the Lord. Don't let anybody kid you. It was not started by the Muslims. It was not started by the Jews. It was not started by the socialist. It was started by the God-fearing people who came and said, give us a place where we may worship our God. And I know the history teachers will say, no, no, it was economic. It was not economic, not mainly. Wasn't anything economic to get here to. It was a place to worship God. And now, ask the pastor in Canada if you could get to the jail cell where he is, who had a service without mask. And they put him in jail, and he's facing another jail term now. And ask another one who was bound and handcuffed on an interstate highway there. It will not be long until the sounds from the north will be heard in the south. And if we are going to do anything about it, we must do it now. And as your pastor, I call on you to let's start praying for our schools. And if you haven't prayed for our school, I want you to pray for the greatest school on earth right here. And we must have this school. Soon at this school, there is going to be an influx. This is total just speculation, of course. There's going to be an influx of people who are going to want to come to this school because they do not want their children to be in mask at a place or at home, and they're going to have to come to a public, to a private school, and we're going to have to make ready for them and get ready, okay? Because we must have this place where we're seeing sometimes 30 or 40 at one time being baptized over there in a hole with a tub over there because they preach the gospel in that school and these children are coming to Christ. And we must. Josh, am I right, sir? Glory. I don't know if Mrs. is here or not, but I'm telling you, they are doing a job that just won't quit. It's really great. We must have it. We must pray for the government. We must pray for our military. We must lift our military up, our generals. We must pray for our policemen. You say, be careful now. Don't say that because folks don't want you to pray for policemen. I'm praying for them, pulling for them, buying them anything I can, complimenting them, and assuring them that they are doing a good job and trying to drive within the speed limit. Because I believe in a police force. And I'm proud of them. And we must pray for our homes. We must pray that God will touch our homes. A recent study was done to a certain group of boys who were in the junior high, and the study revealed the following. The boys said they had a total of 7.5 minutes a day during a period of 2 or 3 weeks with their father. Will you stand with me, please? Now, here is our scripture. If my people, will you say it with me? Who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways. They will seek my face. I will hear from heaven. I will heal their land and forgive their sins. Do you believe that? Now, we're over as far as church is concerned. But now I'm going to ask us for the month of July. I'm going to ask us to go down on our knees. I don't know how you do it, but when I pray, and I say to a person, I'm praying for you, I may be the only hope that person's got. Do you realize that? If I say, I'm going to pray for you, Tommy, Pastor Tommy, and I don't pray, I am lying. I am defrauding that person. When I say I'm going to pray for you, I mean I'm going to call your name. Do you understand it? And this is what I do, my wife and I. We spend a lot of time in prayer. And every time that we pray, 3 times a day, 4 times a day, we're going to call those names to the Lord in prayer. We even have them out so that we say, Lord, bless Betty and Betty and Betty. He knows exactly who's in the mind. Lord, bless Kim and Barbara. We've got them down. Bless Paul and Roland and Wade and Fred. See, we got a mixture there. Bless Mother Epla. Bless Mavis, who had a hip fracture and is in excruciating pain. And Sister Faye says, you don't know what excruciating is until you have a fracture in the hip. Go and talk to a man by the name of Paul. I don't think Paul is here today, is he? Can anybody tell me back there? Paul Hill is not here. Talk to a man like Paul and hear him say, I'm doing pretty poor. He's telling you the truth. And then pass it up and say, I'm praying for you, and then don't pray for him. Something's wrong. You've got too many other things to do. There's nothing as important as your getting in touch with God. And everybody can do it. Here's the way you do it. You don't have to get in and do a chant. You just say, Lord, I ask you to touch Paul Hill today in Jesus' name. You go down this list. And I went down the list and I wrote out 22 the day. When I hear Roland say, Pastor, I can move my right leg, but I can't move my left leg. And I want to stand up and I want to try to walk, and they're trying to make me take one step. And I said, what is wrong there now? And he said, my hips won't hold me. And he says, I want to do it, and I don't want to be a burden to anybody. And then he says, listen, I'll tell you, I can tell you there's one man that really has never forsaken me. Now, I know you're not supposed to do this in church, but I'm going to do it anyway. He said three times at least every week he comes down to Lumberton and shaves me. He said he started out at 10:15 from Fayetteville and got there at 2-something with the traffic so heavy the other day. He said, that's Randy Bullitt. And he says, others have come, and others out of the church, like Moose Butler and people like that have come. Look, what would happen to a man's thoughts if we just went to Hallmark or to, where is it at, CVS or Walgreens, bought a simple card and just write something on it and say, Roland, I'm praying for you, and pray for him right then. Lay hands on that and pray and send it to him. It would do something. We ought to bombard him with cards and with cards. But more than that, we ought to pray for our nation. Now, I'm going to ask you, because I drive a hard bargain when it comes to commitment. Don't do this if you're not committed. I don't want anybody to lie about it. I want you to be honest with me, with God. I know this. I want Pastor Tommy, Pastor Josh, Pastor Eddie, to start up this way, if you wouldn't come behind me here, if you would, okay. Pastor, I believe in the homes, first of all. And during this time of COVID and all this other stuff that's going on, we're going to pray that our homes will not disintegrate. There will be no killings. I believe in them, and I'm going to pray for our homes every day in the month, every day. I don't care when it is. I don't care if you're sitting, riding, walking, training, running, jumping. It doesn't matter, but you're going to pray, not just say, Lord bless me, but I mean really pray. I want to see your hand. I believe you. I can't tell all the hands. It doesn't matter, but it's just that you're making a commitment now. Pastor, I'm going to pray for our schools, because our schools must have a move of the Holy Spirit to set them free, because they're being overtaken right now by people who do not have God. I'm man enough to say it. They do not have God. They serve a rock, something or less, or a dead man. But I'm going to pray, Pastor, that God is going to stir our schools and stir the teacher group around the nation. I'm praying with you, Pastor, during the month of July. All right? That means you're going to start writing it down. Now I'm going to ask you, will you pray for the military? Let me see your hands. You'll pray for the military. Let me ask your hand on this. I really want it. Will you pray for every defense person and first responder? We got to have these people, folks, in this county, okay? Will you pray for them? Do something good for them. Say something good. Just look at them and say, thank you very much. Will you pray for our president and our whole government? Will you do it? Amen. Now I ask you last. Will you pray during the month of October? I've got something in October coming. Will you pray during the month of July that God will send an old-fashioned Holy Ghost revival that'll close the beer parlors and close the go-go joints and close the pool halls and close everything else that's not right with God, that they'll be closed and that we'll come back to church and say, listen, it's God who's got to see that this republic stands as it is. Will you raise your hand and say, Pastor, I'll pray every day. Say it every day. I didn't hear you. Every day. One more time. Every day. Now, together, we've heard and seen these hands go up. And now, Lord, every day we're going to our knees. We're going to go to our knees, Lord. And inside and out, Lord, and outside when we can, but inside when we can't, Lord, and we're going to pray for these things. We're going to write them down, and we're going to believe you, Lord, for great things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. And now I want Chuck to come, and I want him to lead us right now in this song that we're going to close out with. I believe it's God Bless America. I want you to sing it with all your heart, and then I'll come back and I'll dismiss, okay? Let's sing it together. Ascend unto the Lord, unto this holy hill, except he that hath clean hands and a pure heart. And we do it in the beauty of holiness. Holiness unto the Lord for our nation. Father, for our nation today, we pray that you will bring an old-fashioned revival. Let it start right now, Lord, somewhere inside it. Let there be a coming together in unity. Let us get a sign, Lord, we pray. We come against fascism and Marxism and socialism and all the other isms because we believe in a republic, a free republic. Lord, bless our schools and our churches and our homes, our police force and our military. Lord, keep your hand upon your people and those who are traveling today, Lord, to different places to see the children. We pray, God, that you would be near them and in them and give them divine protection. And Lord, may we be ready for what you want us to do. We ask it in the name of Jesus.